try and forgive all the taping here that I'm doing. I'm just setting an example. This is the time when every one of us, each one of us, has to do everything they possibly can. Okay, go as fast as possible, even though you're tired, you're stressed out, I'm exhausted. But I want everyone to have faith that they're going to succeed, that we'll succeed. That's what I'm doing. I don't know exactly what the success, what form it will take, but I have faith that I'm going to get it. Not quite sure what it is I'm going to get, but I'm going to get it. I know I'm very close, right on the brink for sure. Very nervous, very nervous. But we have to push it through because the times are going to push back on us for sure. That's what I'm concerned about. Yeah, backsliding. So we've got to keep the momentum of the times. We have to keep pushing. So somehow you're gonna come across the help you need in unexpected places. I did tonight, coming across a video on A Course in Miracles, and was reading a chapter, and I listened to it, and it just totally resonated with where I'm at right now. It's on YouTube. It was just tremendous. So that just suddenly just widened everything out, and I said, "Oh my gosh, I think I feel like I get it." So there is a feeling that it's deepening, it's getting clearer. And how well, you know, to express it, well, the push is still here. Keep your push going. Keep the push going. My nerves feel shot. You know, I feel like I'm at the end of the rope, actually. It's been a huge, huge strain. This is not easy for the nervous system, you know, and the feeling that, wow, just, you know, turning as fast as possible puts a lot of strain on the overall psyche constellation. Rapid changing of beliefs, changing of perception, changing of outlook. Changing of expectations, very rapid. But I'm still fine. I'm still fine. But the strain is. I sleep a lot now. I have to sleep a lot, and I feel tired again right away. You know, there's no stamina. There's no reserve. I spend it all in just a huge burst of effort. I've seen that bodies, form is an excuse that we've invented, an excuse to justify building, trying to empower our own projections, our own defense system, to defend us against God, because we look at the bodies, all these bodies in the world, and we say, look how vulnerable they are. I mean, their next breath is not even assured at all. Their life can be snuffed out like that, and in fact, the news is full of lives that are being snuffed out constantly. So we look at this and say, look how vulnerable, how utterly, incredibly tiny, vulnerable we all are, all these bodies are. This justifies a massive attempt to protect these bodies. And so we need to empower our psychic projections to protect these frail, vulnerable bodies. But the truth is that these bodies are not us at all. They're just a tactic that we're employing. Just a tactic. A motivational tactic is all it really is. So from that standpoint, we can still see all the bodies in the world. It's just that we see them all as a totality, like a part of a tapestry, a vast tapestry that is absolutely, totally one with all that is. That is abiding in the pure spaciousness. Everything is abiding in the pure spaciousness equally. Location doesn't matter at all. And so we don't have to see bodies as if they were actual persons or individuals or identities or anything like that. We can still see the overall tapestry, I believe. There's something like that, you know, that we're going towards. It's a little difficult to pin down, but we can try. We keep trying. But at any rate, something is going to deepen. Something is going to deepen. I just have faith in that. I just have faith that the progress will continue. And the next progress that I get is likely to vault me into some sort of vision of oneness, actually, because that just seems to be the next step that is there. So, okay. So nothing is vulnerable to being taken out of everywhereness. There is no vulnerability. So what are we talking about vulnerability for? Whatever state a mechanism is in, or no mechanism, everything is equally, optimally one. Optimally in the oneness. Everything is optimally in the oneness. Optimally in the oneness. So, where's the vulnerability? There's some little shift here that has to take place. And I'm sure it'll come. It will come. But it better come quickly. Location doesn't matter. Form is saying location matters. Location doesn't matter. Form is just the idea of location, really. It's just the whim of location. What does location matter to everywhereness? Everything is equally blessed with everywhereness. Everything is equally sacred in its everywhereness. And since it is totally centered in everywhereness, it's totally centered in peace and joy and bliss. It's all smoothed out, joy. Because it's perfectly centered in everywhereness, as is everything else. There isn't any exception whatsoever. So there is just this vast, totally smoothed outness in all directions, so to speak, from all things. All things are in this perfect smooth continuum of totally smoothed out vast everywhereness. Everything is in this perfect continuum equally. There's just this perfect plenum, a continuum, totally smoothed out continuum. Everything is abiding in that right now. Eternal life. The smoothed out continuum is the same everywhere. Everywhere. There's no boundaries. There's no point from which there's any distance or location and relative to that point. It's all one smoothed out continuum. So location, the way we see location, doesn't matter in terms of where is it. It's in the same continuum, the pure spaciousness, as is the all of it. Always, anything that can possibly crystallize or seem to crystallize or arise or not crystallize and not arise, it's all in the exact same continuum. So the location is not meaningful in that way. There's no better or worse. There's no closer or farther away. There's no higher or lower. So location doesn't matter. The location of anything doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. As far as the smoothed out continuum goes, it doesn't matter. So nothing needs to be saved. Nothing has to be done. You don't have to move a single little pebble for this to be true. Everything as it is already this way. So there's a different sort of relationship feeling and what is identity really except the maybe the one shared identity. Maybe there's just one identity actually instead of all these separate identities. Maybe there's just one identity. Maybe that because we're denying this one identity, we're seeking for some other identity, which is why we're, you know, struggling with who am I, identity problems and stuff. Well, it's not who am I, it's that there's just one identity, just one identity, one universal eternal life, just one identity. And we are that. All is that. So it's along these lines that I'm sort of feeling like I'm in the ballpark, and it resonates, and I can sort of say, yeah, that's it, yeah. What's wrong with one identity? What's wrong with one identity? Right? What's wrong with that? We all have the identity of eternal life. What's wrong with that? So it's along these lines, just one identity, the identity of eternal life. Everything has that without exception, equally. That's the only identity it is. It doesn't matter what crystallization is or isn't. Location of crystallization is irrelevant to this completely. There's nothing that modifies it, adds or subtracts to it in the slightest bit. So it's not like you lose your identity, it's just simply you realize there's just one identity. This body is the one identity, this table is the one identity, this everything is the same one identity. There isn't any other. We're at the grocery store today, and there was like this rectangular island, deli island, and it was in this sort of a metal rail around it. And there was this little boy who was holding on the rail and sort of sliding along the rail and having great fun. He had his eyes closed. He was doing it with his eyes closed. He was having so much fun. And I didn't quite know what was going on. And he bumped into me, kind of bumped in. And he kind of, I think his eyes opened up, and then he was laughing, 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 laughing. You thought it was the funniest thing. Maybe we have our eyes closed, yeah, like that, right? We just have our eyes closed, and we open our eyes up and say, oh my gosh, there's just this one identity, of course. There's just this, just one identity. There's just one identity. So all of this is a strain. There's no question about it. I never used to talk this way because I said it's just too difficult in some way, but the pressure is on us so severely right now. I just decided I just gotta have to do it anyway and just start talking this way and see what happens. Just do what I thought was just really very difficult. What have we got to lose? You know, maybe it's too difficult, maybe not. But the pressure on us is just ridiculous. It's off the charts right now. I can feel it off the charts. Other people are feeling it too. A tipping point it has been reached. A tipping point has been reached. You can just feel it. So I would say at some point you just go for it. You just go for it. Take your best shot. But what do we got to lose? Nothing to lose, really. Either we make it or we don't. So we might as well try. Not trying is to lose for sure. For sure. So in the past, this is just was all just gobbledygook as far as like, what? You know, how in the world, what is this? It's so nebulous and so abstract, right? And all this stuff. It's just too difficult. You think I'm going to fail for sure? Why should I try something that I know I'm going to fail at? Well, one thing we can do is we can move our comfort zone. So that the more we do this, the easier it gets. So that's not a failure. At least we're moving our comfort zone. At least we're getting used to speaking in this way. Using these very abstract concepts and words. Just one life, just one life, just one. One identity, just one identity. This is the one identity. This is identity. Identity is. Identity is. Identity is. And so we're so verbal, we're waiting for that to be the beginning of some poem or something or some explanation, but no, it just stops right there and we're not used to that. It's a strain. It's a strain on us. To just stop right there. It's like we say, well, there's one identity, okay, and, but no and to it. No and. So it's the stopping that's the difficult part, actually. We can say these things. That's easy, okay? It's easy to say one identity without a second. One identity without a second. This is the one identity without a second. We can say that. But it's the stopping there that causes this reverberation in us like this. into nothing. You don't add on. It's like, no, we don't have like one identity and then another identity. Or we don't have one identity then subtract from it. Fragment it. So speaking in these holistic terms, holistic concepts, these just total holistic concept right now, that is definitely a tremendous strain on us. No question about it. As the non-dualists like to say, full stop. That's one of their catchphrases, full stop. But we're actually saying just the one, you know, the one identity, just doing it, not just saying full stop, but actually coming to a full stop with just, this is the one identity, this is the one identity. The one identity is the one identity, and this is the one identity. Just all those other thoughts are shut out, aren't they? They're all shut out. There's nothing for them to grab a hold of. All our habitual habits of conceptualization and verbalization and thinking and all this stuff, you know, it's just shut out. You're detached from it. And so this just is like, felt like a strain. It's really a strain, very much so. There's no question about it. So it's not easy. It's an intense practice, actually, a very intense practice, and I'm feeling really tired from it. There is this one. This is this one. There is this one. I am this one. That is this one. This is this one. This is this one. That is this one. Over there is this one. Here is this one. This is this one. So the experience is there's some sort of experience like this, wow, almost like thoughtless and speechless and reactionless. There's no reaction, thought, speech, or anything there. It just kind of like gets dampened down, tremendously dampened down. We're not used to that, are we? Aren't we not used to always being vivacious and bubbly, and we've got another thought there, then, you know, we think that's life. Really active emotion, emoting, just talking, verbalizing, thinking thoughts, and chains of thoughts going off and all this stuff. We think that means we're smart, that's life, that's smartness. And here we are, everything just like stops. There's no thought, there's no emoting, there's and we're just like, whoa, what is this? It's like kind of like shock, stunned shock and amazement and a bit of nervousness. So they asked Poonjaji, what do you do? And he said, just be quiet. Just sit here and be quiet. That's what he's talking about, really. That's actually a tremendous strain. It's really the ultimate sadhana, really. I mean, he was just saying, look, if you wanted to be enlightened right now, then just sit there and be silent. Tremendously difficult. Not technically difficult. It's a strain on the psycho system, the whole system we have. Something different, something very unfamiliar to us, actually. That's why I say, you know, whew, wow, it's just really reverberating, no question about it. Now, this little patter that I give, you know, that superficial patter, I'm able to do that somehow I've been doing this for so long, making videos for so long. When did I start? I don't know. 1994, 5 or something. I used to tape every day Course in Miracles, my understanding of it each day and studying it. I would tape like an hour or so every single day for years and years. And then I've been taping video since then. So I've been taping video for a long time, long time. Thousands, thousands of videos, actually. So I'm able to speak, and at the same time, I'm feeling this, you know, wow. It doesn't really take me too far away from it. So it's just some patter, it's just some patter here. Just showing you that you can still talk and function fine, but my mind is like quiet. My mind is like quiet, and my whole system is like stopped, sort of just like, you know, there's really not much going on at all there. It's just kind of like a suspension, like sort of a, whoa. Now, sometimes you can actually stay in it better if you just have this patter, you know, just this patter going on like this. Whereas if you try to intensify the stillness, then things feel all messed up, actually. So, you know, I'm just sort of talking like this, and I'm not really focused on any particular thing. My vision is very diffuse, and I'm just sort of feeling what I'm feeling is all. That's it. Not trying to do anything about it or make it more. I'm not trying to say, oh, is this the silence, the stillness? Okay, let me intensify it. No. Just letting it be just exactly as it is. Just so I think for some people, actually making videos is actually the best meditation for them. It is for me. I feel that I have the most success doing videos without question. So keep in mind that from the day we were born and from many lifetimes and who knows how many, we have been trying to add on to our thoughts, add on to our concepts, more and more and more, be more verbal, say more, seek more, do more, go more, all this stuff, more, 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 more. And here suddenly we're doing less, 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 less. To the point of just utter simplicity, just one identity. And it's like slamming on the brakes. It's like slamming on the brakes here. There's nothing going on in my mind, or, you know, at this right now, really. Very, very minimal as far as there's like maybe a faint tune that some tune always seems to be. I seem to have a jukebox in the brain that always is playing some tune. But it's very, very muted, really. It's just the faint, faint, faint. It's very faint and distant, actually. So there's this faint, distant kind of faint, you know, rumblings of a little tune, a little, but it's nothing that like I pick up on to follow. So this is the teeth, this is the strain, okay? So I understand it now. Yeah, it's very tough. Not too much tough, but it leaves one tired, for sure, for sure. And so you do give up a certain amount of recreational energy, as it were, you know? This takes its toll on you in terms of, like, you really did a tremendously, you know, tough job that you're really tired from, instead of, like, going out and taking, like, a, you know, an 8-hour hike or something, going up to the mountain, or fishing all day, or, you know, whatever you do, gardening, intense gardening all day. Instead of doing that, you're doing this. And you're going to be probably more tired from this than the other stuff. It's more of a strain, actually. So, you know, you're not available to be the life of the party when you're doing this. That's the trade-off. Which is fine with me. But many people, they want to do it all. They say, here you get into a problem. You can't do it all. I could have played golf today, President's Day, not working. I said, wow, it's been a long time. I need the exercise. And I said, you know what, I'm not going to do it. I feel I'm too tired. So I went to the driving range and just hit some balls, and that's it. I didn't even putt. I said, I'm too tired. Can't do it. Hit some tremendous shots, just drives are just unbelievably straight, and it's just incredible. But I got tired. I got real tired. I said, I gotta quit. I can't do it. I'm too tired. That's it. So there's this trade-off. There is a trade-off. And if you're still thinking like, well, yeah, I'm gonna do my meditation, and I'm gonna do my yoga, and then I'm gonna do my music class, and then I'm gonna do my workout class, and then I'm gonna cook dinner, and then I'm gonna go out and watch a movie, and then I'm gonna get up early, and I'm going to put in a 10-hour day, and then I've got my schedule for the next, you know, year is all, month is all scheduled out, and I've got appointments and friends, and I've got a vacation here, and you're not gonna be able to do it. You're not gonna be able to do it, for sure. You can't do it. Because something like this knocks you out so strongly, I don't even know if I can get through tomorrow, to tell you the truth. The idea, you know, there's some vacation, no way. One of the things that Jesus impressed upon me in A Course in Miracles is don't plan for the future. Don't have future plans. And I took that to heart, and so I never plan ahead. I have no idea what I'm gonna do tomorrow. Basically, I know I'm supposed to go to work, but I don't know how that's gonna go. I don't plan vacations ahead. I don't plan anything ahead. I don't want to have any appointments. I don't go see any doctor because I don't have any appointments. I don't want to have anything I'm thinking about ahead, because that would interfere with this effort. Because I'm thinking, whoa, I better not go any further because this is wearing me out. You know, and I've got this vacation coming, or I've got to see my friends, or I'm going to a party. Or I need to drive, you know, 200 miles and see a friend up there, or I gotta play some music, or all this stuff. Now I don't have anything. And my future is like blank. I try to make it as blank as possible. I never even try to think about tomorrow, actually. And it's just 100% effort right now, and let the future, you know, take care of itself. Let the chips fall where they may. Because this takes your energy. It's a strain. No question, it's a big strain. And again, you cannot multitask this successfully. You cannot. You will not get into the teeth of it sufficiently. You will instinctively, intuitively back away from it and say, whoa, that's too much of a strain. I need to keep the momentum of my life going instead of just stopping, this full stop, just coming to this just one statement. That's it. Just one concept. That's it. Just one identity. Just one identity. No need for any thoughts whatsoever. Instead of coming to that, people want to, okay, that's great, I got that, now to keep my thoughts going, as if that's their life, keeping this ball rolling. That's not going to work. That's why those who've succeeded oftentimes been the yogis in the caves, the renunciates, single renunciates. They don't have any plans for their life whatsoever. All they're doing is focusing entirely one identity. And they may sit in meditation for days without just, and then they may wake up and they may eat a little something, you know, and then rest for a while. And it's like that. They're just full on. Problem with this world is that the idea you can do it all is a ruinous idea. Ruinous. I've given up so much, really my whole life. I don't really have a life. It's all been taken away. And in its place, I have this intense effort. It definitely wears me out, but it's the price you pay. It's the price you pay for putting on the brakes. When you put on the brakes hard, you're going to heat up the brake pads and the drum for sure. You're going to heat it up. There's no question. And there's going to be strain there. But don't try to power through with caffeine and stuff, you know, stuff like that, or drugs or whatever. You can end up then too tired. You can end up too exhausted if you're not careful. It's not a physical strength sort of thing at all. It's a deeper thing, even deep in the nervous system. There's something very deep that feels this, you know, wow. A strain, a nervousness, a strain, like, how come I'm not thinking? How come I'm not talking? How come I'm not doing? How come I'm, you know, where's my eye? You know, we identify this little eye with what it, this body does, and the thinking and all the stuff. We think that's identity. And then when all that stops, we say, whoa, where's my identity? Where's my identity? And we're saying, no, there's just one identity. It's this perfect continuum of identity. There's nowhere where there's not identity. There's just this one completely vast, smoothed out identity, which is eternal life. And we don't have to do anything for that to be so. We can't lose it. We can't gain it. We can't lose it. It's already there. And we're just working towards just relaxing into that, actually. But we're so used to identity, meaning what do we accomplish? Where do we go? Who do we know? Who do we see? What do we do? What are we thinking? What are our memories? All this kind of stuff. It has nothing to do with identity. So the mood of repentance, sitting quietly, that helps us. It keeps us from running away from this stoppage, you know, this simplicity. We have to just sit there in the simplicity. There's a strain, big time strain. Some meditations I concentrate on just one thing, right? That's the same principle, right? They're practicing simplicity and stopping all other thoughts, all their considerations. That's a powerful meditation, no question about it. I mean, these various meditations can work if you really get it and it feels right for you. I can see how that would work. That would really be helpful for sure. But not everybody has the type of concentration, meditation. There's different ways to go about it, actually. Some, they chant. What are they doing? They're focused on just this one chant. They might say, om, 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 om. Again, Practicing simplicity. Practicing simplicity. That's all it is. That's all it is. They're just techniques. There's nothing, one concept, as it were. There's just one identity. Getting used to your comfort zone is just, there's just this one identity, and you don't even think about it at all. You're practicing slowing down the entire momentum of all your frantic attempts to attain identity. That's what the techniques do. Here I like to say, you know, this is these short little phrases, and then just stop. And you say it until you just feel this like quiet come upon you, sort of, where everything just kind of stops. Not an abrupt stoppage. You just sort of feel this reverberation, and there's not much going on. You're not really thinking about anything. So that's what's working for me. Some people do the "this is God" thing. This is God. 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 It's the same thing as saying one identity, one identity, one identity, one identity. You know, there are those, that type of practice too. Same thing. But we're pushing fast right now because the search for personal identity, separate identity, is going to, the valuing of that is going to be augmented in this world to a pathetic extent, actually. Not that it hasn't already, but we're going to see a quantum leap in that. I think it's coming up starting tomorrow. It really is. So we have to understand what we're doing at this point. So we're conscious. It's conscious practice. It's conscious practice. We're just getting used to not needing all of that search for identity anymore. Our attempt to attain identity, build identity, gain identity, grow identity, evolve identity. We're getting used to being without that, not needing it. I remember sometimes you have dreams where you're not wearing any clothes. I had one a while ago. And it's like, oh my gosh, and I had to run back home that way and everything. It was just like amazing. It was like, but I actually handled it pretty really, really well in that dream. I woke up, I said, wow, I almost have it. Having no clothes means you've given up all of those attempts to produce, build, evolve identity, and you don't have any of that anymore. So you're not clothed in all that. And so yeah, people are looking at you like, you know, what's wrong with them? They don't have any clothes on. Even though they're not trying to attain identity. There's no thoughts there. They're just quiet. They're just still. You know, it's like, it's as if you're not wearing any clothes. You know, and people look at you like, that's not right. That's not right. So it puts a lot of pressure on you, right? Oh, I got to go find my clothes. I got to cover up. I got to find clothes. No. So if this stillness continues, you just continue to just be there. Just be there with it, that's all. Don't try to add to it, don't try to subtract to it. Just, if it's going to be there, just let it be there. Again, don't try to add to it. That's just as much a problem as subtracting from it. Don't try to augment it, amplify it, do anything with it. Just be there with it. Because these declarations we're making really slam the brakes on, and you're going to feel it. You know, I could easily just get up this second, turn off the lights, and go back in, and you know, get right to what I'm doing. It's not the slightest problem at all. But I could also just sit here with this sort of state of mind that is sort of stunned in a certain way, stopped in a certain way. There's no reaction going. There's nothing like ping pong and reaction going on, really. It's just no reaction is taking place. Except it's sort of a generalized strain and nervousness of like, why are there no reactions taking place? It's like, what's going on? Am I dying? I'm not thinking that, but I think deep down inside, something is saying, hey, are you dying? I mean, what's going on? How come we're not, you know, living, seeking, growing, trying, surviving, striving, stressing, battling, competing, emoting, reacting, deceiving, moving, fighting, struggling, interacting, relating, all of, how come none of that's going on? Because we are decided to realize the one identity. That's why. Things have gotten real silent now. And it's very interesting that I'm doing this taping outside. It is, I think it's about 11 p.m., pitch dark, a little bit cold, very quiet, very still, very silent. I can't see anything beyond these lights. It's all pitch dark. So it's actually a pretty doggone good setting for this. No distractions, except for the cat. The cat's always kind of moving around, wants to probably go in at some point, get its midnight snack. You see, if we struggle too much, then we're right back into trying to obtain something, right back in the identity of striving, right? So I'm saying just be with the stillness, just be with it. Don't say, okay, let me augment it here. Let me get real serious. Let me try to produce even greater stillness. Don't do that. That is actually, you're right again back into thinking, reacting, striving, struggling, all that stuff. Now, the declarations themselves, I'm finding, are bringing the stop. And then just sit in that. Just sit. Don't do anything about it. Don't add or subtract from it. What I do, I'm just sort of aware, just diffusely aware, just to have a diffuse awareness, nothing, no sharp awareness about it, you know, one way or the other. Just sort of a general diffuse sitting and awareness of not naming, not categorizing anything. Just kind of patiently waiting without giving thought to it. waiting for the next thing to say. I'm just kind of waiting for it to calm down. Just waiting for it to calm down is all. And I find this is very helpful. If you do have, say, okay, I'm going to say something a little while, then you're just waiting to for everything to calm down until you can say something, make another declaration. So that really helps you stay in the moment and just sit with it. Because you think, okay, there'll be another declaration in a little while that's really helpful, so I'm just going to wait for that. That's what I do. I find it's very effective. Not thinking of what the declaration is. I say it'll pop into my mind when I calm down a little bit, when this you know, smooths out, that's all. So just waiting for that to happen. And then something will come along, somehow the cat will come along or something, and everything just sort of will support whatever you're doing in some way. And a little bit of patter, a little talk, it helps you to stay kind of right with it. You don't try to get into it. Don't get into your state. Because that's striving, again. That's striving. You don't need that. You don't need to do anything. There's just this one identity. There's just this perfect continuum. Everything is wordlessly there. Concept-free there. Conceptually free there. Everything is just conceptually free there. Everything is just there, free from all concepts of being there. Wordlessly there, we can say. That's easier to say that way. Just wordlessly there. Everything, this table is just wordlessly there. This table is wordlessly here. This bottle is wordlessly here, wordlessly one, we're wordlessly one. This plant is wordlessly here. And more than that, there's as it is. It is here as it is. Everything as it is here. Everything as it is here. Everything as it is here. Everything is here as it is. Without any description, without any words, without any explanation, without any doing or undoing. That plant is aware that I'm in the same continuum as it is. It doesn't have anything do anything for me to be there. You see? It frees everything up. Everything is free. Everything is freed. Everything is free. Everything is inherently free of any need or obligation or action towards anything else. Everything is totally free. Because it's in free relationship with everything else in the exact same continuum. Nothing it has to do for that to be so. It doesn't have to be something for this to be so. It doesn't have to change what it is for it to be so. It doesn't have to stay the same for it to be so. This moment, free. This moment, free. This moment, this plant as it is free now. The freedom of this plant is now. The freedom of this table is now. The freedom of this body is now. Freedom is now. Freedom is now. Freedom is now. Without a second. Freedom is now. Without a second. Freedom is here now. Freedom is here now. And the whole verbal matrix is like it can't really say anything. From the standpoint, the patter is the patter, but as far as coming from a, you know, the part, the type of say, talk speech which throws a block into your path, right? That speech, it really can't say anything. It's not saying anything. The questioning, the disputing, the questioning, all the trickery, all that stuff, the egoic talk and concepts and questioning and doubts and all these things, they're just kind of like like stuck. Like in a groove, like the record used to have vinyl records, and the needle, there, sometimes there'd be a groove would be damaged, and it would just go around and around and around in the same groove. they can't go any further into the song. Stopped, you know, just nothing. So, it's kind of like a big, huh? What? Huh? Wow, what? What? That's about it. Very cool, very nice. Now, after this effort is over, there's a tendency you want to dive back into graphics and words and all this stuff for some music and songs. I'm desperate for content, you know, that kind of thing. So, like at retreats, you know, they don't have any of that stuff. They shouldn't. And so you go back to your room and you're caught and, or something, and, or you go to collective prayer or something. So there's some religious orders, etc. They know what they're doing. I mean, the program is designed again to slow it all down until you can just feel comfortable without abiding the one as the one identity, and you don't need all the thoughts and all this kind of stuff. It slows it down gradually. Some people will eat, they need to feel like, I'm still alive, I'm still doing something, I'm still processing something, I'm still, you know, consuming something, all this stuff. So, that's a battle, that's what I'm finding. I'm just noticing that the ego will say, oh, okay, you're done? Great. Let's go listen to a really cool song, you know. I know a really good one. The ego say, I know a really good song that you like. That's what it does. Yeah, it's on YouTube. Do a search for it, and then you find it and listen to it. So, oh, yeah, that's a catchy. I like that song. The ego says, see, I knew I could find a song you liked. So it's kind of like the ego's like trying to resuscitate you. The ego thought like you went into a coma or something, and it's like desperate to resuscitate you. But we're not going into a coma. We're awakening from the coma. The ego wants to put us back in the coma. One trick I do to trick the ego is I tape late at night, and so I keep going and going until it's midnight, and then I just go in and go straight to bed. No time for it to say, listen to this YouTube song. But it tries anyway. It says, all right, before you go to bed, come on. Just give this, you're gonna love this song. I know you're gonna love this song. I got a favorite for you. So, if I just taped really late, you know, I say, ego, I can't do it. It's too late. I don't have time for that. I just gotta go straight to sleep. we're understanding why meditation, why these techniques actually work, what we're doing, and why the strain is there, how the ego tries to resuscitate us, etc. It's like, it's becoming, you know, open. It's an open secret now. It's an open secret. It's not a secret anymore. Which makes it much easier. Much more comfortable, actually. So that's great. And, well, it's not too late. But I do have to upload this video and get it there. So we have it as we... cat, ow! Cat is... All right. Cat wants to go inside. So we have it on this Tuesday. This Tuesday. Because as I've seen in the dream last night, we're going to start getting really heavily acted upon here. The action is going to really pick up, which of course we don't want. We want the non-action. We're disassociating from all that striving for identity, this trying to establish an identity. We're letting go of all that. We're saying, we already have the one identity. Everything has the one identity. Without anything changing or not changing, it makes no difference. As it is, as it is, as it is, as it is. As it is. As it is. All right. Very great. I'll see if I'll get this one up so it'll be available at some point Tuesday. Okay, very great. That's it.